She is going to talk to, she has a PhD in medieval history and teaches graduate courses. And this particular course that sort of drove her to think about this was a history of sexuality course.
All right, well, it's great to be here, and it's a pleasure to talk to all of you. This is actually, when I finish here, I'm going to be heading back to get ready for my first night of this class. and the history of sexuality is a class that I've been teaching at the University of Pennsylvania now, oh my goodness, probably since around 1999. I first was teaching it in a face-to-face version, completely face-to-face, sort of traditional upper-level seminar class. Starting in about 2008, I shifted the class over to completely online. The School of Arts and Sciences at Penn is certainly not a huge online presence. I mean, compared to some schools that have completely online degrees, or where you see, you know, scores of online courses that they're offering. We have a handful of courses that we've been offering online in the fall and the spring, and then we do a few more over the summer. But again, this is basically an initiative that we've been working in the Division of Professional and Liberal Education, partially because we do have a lot of students who are adults who are working full-time, who like to have an opportunity, in some cases maybe because they have a busy travel schedule, or because they're really tired of fighting rush hour traffic to come into an evening class. They like to be able to take online classes when they can. We've also discovered that over the summer, when a lot of our traditional undergrads are doing internships over the summer, they have to choose between taking a course and doing an internship. In some cases, having online classes was something that was really useful. One of the elements, though, that was a real challenge is that our faculty, or probably like all of your faculty, wanting to make certain that any classes we offer have a very high level of student engagement. And I'm going to be talking a little bit more about, I think a lot of engagement is something that we tend to throw around as something that we want, but I'm going to talk a little bit more specifically later about what that means to me when I'm teaching. So for me, part of this was that this was a class I was teaching for a while. I love teaching it. It's one where the students tend to do the reading assignments over the summer, so that's good. But it also was something where I wanted to have an opportunity to think differently pedagogically, to try out some new things. So what I'm going to do is give you a sense of how this course was set up online and the ways that even though this is a completely online course, I think a lot of the things I tried out with the asynchronous components are things that could work very nicely in a blended classroom environment, too. I'm going to talk about the challenges and goals that I had, the approaches that I took to fostering student engagement online and what that meant to me. I'm going to focus specifically on threaded discussions and blogs. And then I'm also going to talk a little bit, for those of you who are librarians in the audience, we're actually going to have a pilot this summer with embedded reference librarians. So this is another way to think about fostering more engagement, basically. I love the idea of an embedded librarian. All right, so just to show you the way that this course is set up. When I had taught it before, and the platform that you see here was from Going On Networks. We basically had partnered with them in around 2008 to come up with a learning management system that we could use not only for online credit courses, but also for non-credit courses. And we also have some online student communities attached to some of our professional master's degrees. So there were a lot of things we wanted to do. One of the issues with all the change that Jennifer talked about is that Going On went out of business basically midway through this past spring semester while I was teaching on it. So we had a very rapid transition from that to Canvas. And I'm going to be teaching this class on Canvas. It was actually relatively simple for us to transfer the course site over. The asynchronous course site for students has a number of different elements to it. It basically, the students would navigate through the different weeks, and as they would see a different week for the class, they would see a course overview from me, which basically told them what my goals were for them with the material we would be covering that week. They also could access the readings if we had PDFs and other reading assignments that they were going to be doing. This is also where they found blogs and threaded discussions, which were some of the main elements that they were using basically for the asynchronous work that they were doing in the classes. So basically, this is a site that was set up not only as a place where students were going to kind of get information one way, where they were going to be downloading readings or where they would be reading what I wanted. I also made it very clear to them that this is a place for them to discuss, to reflect, to share ideas with each other, to work through complicated course topics and themes together and with me, and to practice writing in different forums. So this is something I made clear from the beginning. And I didn't just make it clear in the first class, I also made it clear when they saw the ways I was defining participation in the class. So participation is something that was happening both asynchronously and then also in real time. The real-time component, obviously that's not me, we're using an Adobe Connect classroom, basically. So students are going to be logging on this summer every Monday evening from 6 to 8:30. They appear over here in the participant list. It is possible to use a webcam if you want, either as the instructor or to have the students use it. I haven't used it because it has a tendency sometimes to lead us into some bandwidth issues, and it just seemed easier not to go in that direction. What I do, though, is the students are mic'd, and the students also have a chat that they can be participating in for class discussion, where they raise their hands, they go up to the participant list. I'm mic'd throughout the class, and I also have a PowerPoint in the middle where I show them images, where I lead them through discussion points. It basically is a way for them to stay focused. Sometimes I'll put primary sources up and we'll do a close reading of them, et cetera. So it's good for them to have something visual to focus on here. But what ends up happening in this classroom setting, it's very much like what I would do before in a face-to-face classroom. We're having class discussions. Students are leading presentations. There's a real focus on the real-time discussions that they're doing. The course itself is an advanced seminar. PEN 400 level seminars can be taken by advanced undergraduates, by post-baccalaureate students, or by graduate students if they do some additional work for the class. Especially over the summer, I tend to have a real mixed population of students in the class. So they'll be mixed in terms of the academic level that they're on. This is covering a wide span of time as well, and there are no prerequisites. So what that basically means is that, you know, I'm spending a week on Greece, a week on Rome. I have to make certain that they have enough background to really understand some of the issues and the historical elements that I want them to keep in mind when they're reading secondary sources as we move throughout the class. Students tend to have a wide series of different goals and reasons why they're taking the class. One thing that is good is that because this isn't a core, I mean, this is basically an elective for students, they tend to take it because they're interested. So that's half the battle right there. My goals in teaching this class, though, were I wanted to enhance student engagement. And one of the ways that I was thinking about this is that when I would teach face-to-face with no asynchronous elements to the class, you know, the students would basically, I think, often do the readings the night before class. I mean, they would come in prepared. But they wouldn't, I didn't have as much control over how they were thinking through these course elements as they moved throughout the week. And many of the topics and issues that we're exploring are incredibly complicated themes. And I wanted them to have an opportunity, not just to kind of prepare for one class session and then focus on the next thing, but I wanted to drive them to continue to think about and critically assess the issues we were discussing in class. I thought that that was really important. I also think that because they're coming in from varying levels, I wanted to have more of an opportunity to determine what their questions were, what they're confused about, how they're understanding and applying class material. I thought that was really important. In giving me ideas of what questions do they have that we need to address in more detail in class. I think that you know, for me, this is not a class where I was requiring students to read a lot of primary sources, but they were reading critically historians' analyses of primary sources, which meant that they needed to be able to ask questions. They needed to not sort of focus on the readings as a way to memorize facts, but they needed to think about interpretation and use of evidence and arguments. And some of the challenges that they were seeing and questions that were coming up as they were grappling with this material. And even though I wasn't going to be focusing on primary sources, I was thinking, this might be an opportunity for me to give them some other opportunities to engage in primary sources and reading them and thinking about them as they move through the class session. So these were the goals that I had in moving the class over. I also wanted to really think to myself about what I meant about student engagement. I had an idea here that part of what was important to me was that the students were not just having their learning driven by me, but they were also thinking actively and engaging critically in the course, and that they were identifying topics and questions they wanted to learn more about. This didn't mean that I was abrogating all responsibility for determining the learning outcomes to the students, but I do think that there was a place for them, and especially when I was dealing with some graduate students within the class, they needed to come into this class really thinking actively about how it fit in with the research they were doing. So that was really important. I also think in a class like this, it's really important for students to determine appropriate ways to make connections between the course material and other topics and issues that are related that they hear about outside the classroom. Now, I knew from early in that there always are dangers about students making this very anecdotal and personal, and I definitely did not want that to happen. But what I did want was for them to think, for example, if we're reading topics in class having to do with definitions of marriage over time, and they're thinking about current US debates over marriage equality, having them think about how to contextualize that, move that in, how that might help them to ask more questions about contemporary debates, but also how that might ask, you know, lead them to have other questions to ask when they looked into the past as well. So I thought that was really important. That issue I talked about before, that I didn't want them to think about this class as something they were doing on Sundays and Mondays. You know, this is something they needed to engage in throughout the week. It also helped a little bit with, you know, I wanted to help them learn better time management skills in a way. I think that the students also being empowered to critique historians' interpretations of the past was also very important. Part of me empowering students here and engaging them was that I didn't want them to simply think, okay, so-and-so is published at the University of Chicago Press, therefore we can't ask any questions. And I think that the more opportunities that students have to engage in this kind of critical thinking, not only when they're doing their own writing, but also when they're reading scholars' writing, was really important. And then finally, I just want the students to have a sense of being personally invested in the discipline. I knew that this was going to require that they spend a lot of time thinking about the class and engaging in the class, and I wanted them to feel that this was something they wanted to do. So nothing like setting high goals there. The online course components of this basically helped in a couple of ways. One was, as I said before, helping to structure students' engagement in the class material. What I basically had to do for the students is map out for them how they would be engaging in threaded discussions and blogs throughout the class. And so what I do in my first class session is I actually talk to them about how they're going to prepare for class. That they're usually going to be doing the readings, maybe starting on the Thursday or Friday, or definitely the weekend before we have class on Monday. That I open threaded discussion then, and I encourage them to go and post replies to the prompts that I have there, questions that they have, etc. That right before class, they have to have a reflective blog that they complete, and it has to be done on time. And I'll talk a little bit more about the blog later. And then they'll return to the threaded discussion. So what they're basically doing is starting threaded discussion on the course materials that they're reading. We're continuing that in real time during class. And then after class meets, we are then, the students are continuing that threaded discussion after that live class session. I also let them know, because this is the other thing with threaded discussions, if you don't give them incremental due dates, all the posts, except for the ones from team recruit, really, really, you know, on top of the students, are all going to come in at the last minute. And the students that are engaged get frustrated because they're talking to themselves. And all you get is a series of blogs, basically. It's not a threaded discussion. So I basically told the students, you need to have, you know, at least one response that you write to the prompts, you know, by the time class meets. You need to have at least two replies to your classmates done by the Tuesday or Wednesday after. And you have to, in the end, have basically two or three initial replies to prompts, and you need to have a good six replies to your classmates every week. So before I did it like that, it didn't work very well.
How many students typically?
Usually I'm looking at about 15 to 20 students in the class. It's sometimes gone as high as 25. I feel like I can handle up to 20 pretty well by myself with a tech assistant during the real-time class sessions for tech support. Once I get up over 20, I feel like I need a TA just to help, because it's a lot of posts, it's a lot of reading. One of the things I also do, though, with the threaded discussions that has helped a lot is there are different ways that you can show the students you're paying attention to their threaded discussions. I mean, one is to assign a rubric and to give them, you know, kind of incremental assessments of the work that they're doing, basically grade their threaded discussions, not at the end of class, but as you're moving through. Another thing that's really important is that in the beginning of a real-time class session, I would actually pull up examples from threaded discussions and blogs and talk to the students about them, and use that to engage class discussion, use it especially in the beginning of the class to show them really good models so that they had an understanding that a good threaded discussion tends to look, you know, like this as opposed to like this. And I think that by showing them that I was actively taking the questions that they had and incorporating them into my approach to class, also showed them I was paying a lot of attention there. So there are things you can do there. I think especially if the students are really going with class discussion, I'll do a minimal amount of replying back to them, but I also told them, I want this to be your space, but I'm watching it and I'm gonna be evaluating it, and you're gonna be getting feedback on it. I think also, this is the other really important element, is I wanted the students to have different platforms that they could use to develop their own expertise in history of sexuality and to learn from each other. Some of the students who came into the class were, for example, gender studies majors, or they were people who had a really strong background in classical history. And others had a real talent for thinking personally and reflecting about the course material, and talking through how they were learning and how their thinking was changing. So that's the other element where I think the online asynchronous course components really help, is they give students an opportunity and different platforms to demonstrate their expertise to each other and to learn from each other as well as to learn from me. So, okay. So just to show you a few examples, there are different ways that I would think about the discussion forums. One is by having the discussion forums be an extension of synchronous class discussions that we were having. So, you know, in this case, I had students who were trying to determine sort of ways of understanding Ricky Solinger's Pregnancy and Power, which we read toward the end of the class. This was a topic that was very sensitive for students, so I had to talk to them about political sensitivity, both, you know, respecting other viewpoints, both in real-time classes and also in the discussion forums. But then the other element that ended up happening here is that students were starting to apply and sort of going off of some of the thoughts that Sam first had, then Elena sort of moved that in a different direction. I had students basically exploring these ideas together, trying to think about how to expand some of the discussions that we were having in class. Class, we were talking a lot more about Solinger's take on the past. This was a place where they were spending a lot more time applying the historical context to the present.
So it was interesting to see them do that, and it's something where in this class we meet for 2.5 hours, and I never feel like there's enough time to go over everything students want to go over. So this gives us a way to expand that. The other issue that tends to be really helpful with the discussion forums is they're encouraging students to reflect and to critically engage in the materials that they're reading. The way the class is set up basically is they read Jeffrey Weeks's book, Sexuality, which introduces them to some key social science definitions and understandings of gender roles and sexual roles in the very beginning of the class. And then we move into looking at Greece and Rome. So these are the students' first opportunities to try to apply some of these concepts. And they're applying them often to a time period that is so foreign to them, they haven't learned very much about. And so because of that, one of the things I found fascinating was seeing how the students here were taking, for example, the concept of maleness and trying to understand how to apply that concept of Weeks to their reading of Skinner. And that was fascinating to me. And it also showed opportunities there that the students were taking to basically learn from each other, to engage with each other. I was able to use this as a jumping off point in class, in the next class session, to help them hone and refine the way they were applying some of these concepts. But there's something that's really exciting as a faculty member about getting to see how students are thinking and trying out new ideas and willing in some cases to make mistakes. I think that's the other thing, when they're doing really complicated critical reasoning. We also, in some cases, like next week is going to be Memorial Day, so I'm going to be replacing our synchronous class session for that week with an asynchronous discussion forum, basically. So it gives me a way not to lose a week in a semester, not to have to deal with trying to reschedule that real-time class session, but to keep the students moving and engaged and really thinking. And then also this whole idea here about deepening student learning. One of the things that happened when we had class discussion is students started asking about concepts and understandings of asexuality. I didn't have any readings in the class on this. This is actually a relatively new area of research. And so I pulled some readings for the students. And I set up a discussion forum so that after class, they could continue to engage in some of these questions that they had. So, and students did that. It was set up for extra credit, but they read and they engaged and they thought about it. So that was also really nice to see. I also assigned blogs to the students. And so every week the students were writing a blog, which is supposed to show their personal reflection on whatever the topics are that they're reading about in class for that week. I encourage them to feel free to bring in outside class materials as long as in an academic sense as well as a personal sense they can make those sorts of connections. Students also were not required to comment on each other's blogs, but they did. And as they were moving closer to writing their review essays, I saw more and more students who were kind of specializing in different areas, and I could kind of guess which blogs they were going to be popping up on, and sure enough, they were there. So I think that's one of the signs I have that the engagement piece of the class is working really well. As the students were looking for extra opportunities at that point. I did make clear to them that when they were doing threaded discussions, that these were the rubrics that I was going to be using to assess their work. And again, I think this is really important to make certain that if you were requiring something like a threaded discussion, if it's just optional and it's just floating out there and it's very general, students won't do much with it. You need to have it active and engaging from the very beginning, and students need to have motivation to use it. And then I also came up with a different rubric for the blogs. There's some areas here that are similar, and there's some areas that are a bit different from the threaded discussions. And again, I also made certain that the students saw that timeliness was important, quality of writing was important, but also I was starting by looking at critical analysis and reflection. Yes?
I'm sorry if I missed this.
Sure.
Are the blogs each student having an individual block each week, and it's just open-ended? Are the blocks given any kind of a theme, or are those only in the threaded discussion?
Yeah, the only, I give the students prompts in the threaded discussion. Those are pretty specific. In the logs, the only prompt I give the students is that it has to somehow relate to a topic or a theme that they read for class that week. But other than that, I leave it open. Mm-hmm. So I also gave them examples of blogs before the class started so they knew what I meant. So that was also helpful, I think. So basically, I mean, I think, again, the other element I should mention here is that I did also have extra credit assignments for students where they would have opportunities to read primary sources that related to a topic we're going to be discussing for that week. So I'd put up a primary source, and students for extra credit could basically go in and they could say what questions arise. How does that relate? How did that source relate to the secondary source readings that we were looking at for that week, et cetera? And I think that was a really good opportunity. Students did take advantage of the primary source blogs. I think that it helped them to sharpen their analysis of secondary sources as well, which was really useful. It took a little bit of time for me to set up, but it was a nice element to add into the class. So one final thing I wanted to mention in terms of engagement is that this summer, I'm going to have two embedded reference librarians in my class. They are very interested in determining ways that they can enhance students' learning experience in summer classes that we offer. And so they're going to basically be sitting in on the real-time class sessions. They also are going to comment on student blogs, and one of them is going to write a blog himself about resources that relate to the different topics that we discuss in class. We also created something we call the library lounge, which is basically another space on the course site where students can go in and they can basically ask questions, interact with the librarian. One of the things we're trying to do is move the use of the library beyond simply research papers. I mean, the use of the library for research papers is also important. In this class, my students are writing a review essay, so having some help finding, you know, 3, 4, 5 books for that will be good. But I think what's even more powerful is sort of building on that asexuality discussion, giving students opportunities to understand how to follow up on topics of interest to them as they move through the class. So, all right, so that's, I mean, basically it's a really fun class to teach. And it's been a pleasure talking to you. So if you have any questions, please.
Can you give us more sense of how the live class goes?
Sure.
Are you speaking most of the time, or what are the mechanics and the interaction?
Sure. I'm basically, what tends to happen is in the beginning of the class, I give them some historical detail, some background about, okay, here are some historical themes to think about as we move through this discussion. I also bring in some of the topics that they discuss in threaded discussion in their blogs. But then beyond that, I basically have a series of discussion questions I'm leading the students through. And I also usually have 2 or 3 students every week who are also writing response papers and coming up with some of their own discussion questions. So what will happen there is I'll organize their questions. I'll work with them outside of class to help them to do that. They will basically monitor class discussion, lead class discussion themselves for 2 questions each, but I'll be there to help develop the class. But otherwise, it works very much as any other seminar class I've ever taught, where I ask questions. I usually have the questions kind of come up on the PowerPoint that I'm using to help students stay engaged. And usually at the very end of class, I'll have us do a primary source exercise or something, because 2.5 straight hours is a long period of time. And so giving them something like that so that we're kind of changing things up a little bit is really helpful. It is also possible, by the way, to do small group work in the Adobe Classroom site. That's something I do more for another course that I teach than for this one. But you can actually have breakout sessions. So you can give students small group work, have them each go into a breakout room and kind of move from room to room to see how they're doing. So, yes.
Do Do you think the online environment encourages questioning?
I think so. I mean, I think it's really hard for students to hide online. I mean, really, that doesn't sound right, but for example, during the real-time class sessions, I mean, I print out a copy of the chat transcript from the students, and we archive every class, and they know that, you know, and so I am very aware when students are participating or when they're not participating. But the other thing that I think it helps with is I've noticed students who really like having a choice of going back and forth between typing a question in chat and moving back to the microphone. And some students who are very nervous about speaking in class and have told me they feel empowered by being able to write in that way. So I think it's like any other class. You need to set up the rules and the guidelines. And I think especially for a class like this, I mean, I think that it helps some of the students to really pay attention to what they're saying in class, and I remind them they will be recorded. It's kind of helped to tone down some of the, you know, risque anecdotes that they might otherwise be telling. So, yeah. Yes.
This is on a little different uh-huh. line, but I'm wondering how these courses are being archived for the faculty review process.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because the standard is to review in the medium in which it was developed.
Yep.
So I'm wondering if you or if anybody else has thought about
that. That's an excellent question, because it's something that actually School of Arts and Sciences is really grappling with right now. Usually the curriculum committee there is doing a lot of review based on the printed syllabus of the class.
Mm-hmm.
And then internally within the departments, there will be class observations and things like that. But the curriculum committee itself is really just evaluating the syllabus. So the thing that gets tricky with online is we actually have a lot more material that they could review. I mean, they could sit there and they could view the archives. What we've ended up doing is having a series of presentations to the curriculum committee to explain to them these are the way these classes are set up, and to answer questions so that they understood that context. We then make available the archives if the faculty want to go in and look at them. Usually that's not something that the individual faculty members on the review committee want to spend a lot of time doing, but we have had to talk to them about things like how do you assess and understand the relationship and contact hours between face-to-face contact hours during a real-time class session and the asynchronous elements. And that's something that we have to not only work with the curriculum committee on, but really that goes out to a department-by-department level, because that's where a lot of that review is taking place. So,
about tenure and promotion?
Mm-hmm. Well, at this point, any of the classes that are being taught this way are classes that are being taught overload. So they're out of load. They tend to be summer classes or evening classes. We do have an online faculty committee that is right now working with the dean's office and then also working with PLE to try to determine are there other ways to incent faculty to work online. I think that the Coursera initiative and a focus on flipping classes has actually led many more faculty to have a lot of these questions. But again, right now, I don't think the school has a really good setup to think about how to incent faculty within the context of the work they're doing for tenure. Most of the people who are teaching these classes are basically, they're already tenured faculty, they have to be. So
I guess I this is a question that has come up just as we transitioned
sure.
over to Canvas, because Canvas allows for a lot more interactive things.
Oh, yeah.
So we have faculty now who are not even making paper syllabi.
Yeah.
There is no syllabus for
yeah.
the course. It's all online.
Yeah.
And the standard is that is the way it needs to be judged.
Mm-hmm.
How do we archive that so that 5 years down the road when that person
right.
is coming up for tenure, we
right.
can look at that course content?
Right. Yeah, and I think that's challenging. And that is something where I think, when the learning management systems that I'm using, for the most part, until recently, were ones that we were just handling within PLE and we were archiving within PLE for a small number. I think that's an institutional question that I know we are doing a lot more work at Penn now with the library, thinking about how can we work together here. And I do think with more and more emphasis on blended courses, this is going to be more of an issue throughout. So I don't have any good answers other than letting you know that I can definitely see that as an issue, and I think we'll be grappling with it too. Okay, I can stay for other questions later, but thank you all very much. So switching gears a little bit, and yes, I am keeping an eye on the time and will leave time for more questions.